Let's start a new notebook. I'll open up my terminal, and I'll use CD to change my directory to the Documents folder and then the place where I have my Jupyter virtual environment. On Macintosh and Linux, which is where I am, I'll type source /bin/activate to activate the virtual environment. On Windows, you'd type scripts/activate without the word source. Now I'll start Jupyter Notebook. The server starts, the browser comes up, and it shows me the files in my current directory. I'll create a new folder by going to the New drop-down menu at the right-hand side and say New Folder and change its name to Markdown Intro. Then I'll double-click it to open it. This video won't need any data files, but if I did need them, I would use the Upload button at the right-hand side of the screen to upload them into my directory. Now I'll go to the File menu and create a new notebook. Its name is Untitled, which means I'll go to the File menu and save the notebook as, and instead of untitled.ipynb, let's call it markdown.ipynb, and save. It opens in a new tab. I can go back to my Untitled tab, discard any changes, and close that tab. I don't need it anymore. Now that we've done our housekeeping with the file system, let's get back to our notebook. We'll change our first cell from code to markdown so we can enter text into it instead of code. Now at this point you might be asking yourself, what is this markdown anyway? To answer that question, we need to go back to the bad old days before people had computers. Back then, if you wanted something typeset so it would look good, you'd type it up and then mark it up by hand with a red pencil to tell the typesetters how the results should look, where the heading should go, what should be italic, what should be bold, whatever. Enter the world of computers where we can type text. Let's go into our cell here and type Introduction to Markdown. We'll leave a blank line and then say Markdown lets you specify how text should be displayed. Then we're going to add specifications that mark up the text to tell Jupyter how to display it. For example, if we want the first line to be a main heading, we'll put a pound sign and a space at the beginning of the line. And then let's run that. And we'll see that Introduction to Markdown is now a heading. But if this is a markup language, why is it called Markdown? That's because it's designed to be easier to learn and write than a lot of other markup languages, and the name is a reminder of that. We have another cell here, and we're going to make it a markdown cell also. Click back in it, and let's enter some text. We want a subheading. We'll put two pound signs in a row and a space, and then our subheading, which will be italic and bold. To put text in italics, you put one asterisk before it and after it. So I'll put an asterisk and the words "this sentence will be italic," period, and another asterisk. Leave a blank line. And if I want bold, I use two asterisks before the text and two asterisks afterwards. Two asterisks, "this sentence will be bold." And when I run the cell, sure enough, that's what we get. You can also make a specific word italic or bold. For example, I can say, "this is a," two asterisks, "very important," and another two asterisks, "topic." In this case, the words "very important" will show up in bold. Run the cell, and sure enough, that's what happens. Our next question is, what if you actually need a pound sign or asterisks around text? For example, I want to say pound sign is also called the hashtag character. Why is that italics? Oh, that's right. I forgot to change it from code to markdown. And then on the next line here, I will say 3 times 5 is the same as 5 times 3. Now, if I run this cell, you will see that it thinks some of the pound sign is a heading and the asterisks stand for italic. Well, that's certainly not what I want. I'll double-click in this cell so I can resume editing it. The way to turn off the special effects for pound sign and asterisk is to precede them with a backslash. So let's add some text here. Backslashes turn off special effects. And here I'll put a backslash before the pound sign, and I'll put a backslash before each of the asterisks. Now when I run the cell, I get the actual hashtag character and I get the actual asterisks, which is what I wanted. Let's move on to the next topic. We'll change this cell to markdown and we'll make a subheading called lists. And say there are two types of lists, unordered bulleted lists and ordered numbered lists. This comma isn't necessary. And when I run this cell, I see my level 2 heading, my subhead. Let's put this all into one cell. All the things in this cell should really belong together rather than making a separate cell for every paragraph. By the way, when you leave an empty space, that gives you a new paragraph. To make an unordered list, put a single dash at the beginning of every line. In an unordered list, the items don't have any particular order. So, for example, if I wanted keys for success in computer science, on the next line, I'd put a dash and then the words plan before you program, another dash and say read the book. And notice that Jupyter is putting in a dash for me automatically and then ask questions. So those are the keys for success. And let's run this cell and I get a bulleted unordered list. In an ordered list, items have some natural order. Let's go back actually and edit this cell so we keep building on it. Now, notice I have a dash here. How do I get rid of it? The answer is if I press enter again, that'll get me back to my left margin and I can start a new paragraph. To make a numbered list, put numbers and a period at the beginning of each line. So step one is read the data table. Step two is going to be get the temperature column. And then step three is get the average of the resulting array. Those steps have to happen in order. And again, when I run the cell, there's my numbered list. And you will also notice, let me double click in here, that I made temperature bold by enclosing it in 2 asterisks before and 2 asterisks after. That pretty much covers the topic of lists. In this cell, we're going to go to a new topic. Again, we want a subheading, 2 hashtag symbols, and again, remember to change your cell to markdown. And sometimes we need to put in computer code in our text. To create text that looks like computer code, you put it in back quotes. Here's an example. Use the back quote np.average and then close the back quote function to get the average of an array. Let's run this cell and see what it looks like. And we'll see that the thing that was in back quotes is in a gray background and is in computer font. Now the question is, where do you find this on your keyboard? On most United States keyboards, the back quote will be on the same key that has the tilde on the top of it. It's the unshifted tilde, that squiggly line. Its official name is tilde, not squiggly line. And the one that you see pointed to here, that's our back quote. What if you have several lines and you want all of those to be in computer code font? For example, here are some Python statements. Height equals 165, weight equals 59.1, and ratio equals height divided by weight. To put all of those into computer code, I put three back quotes before the lines, and I put another three back quotes after the lines. And when I run this cell, there I get my three lines, and they're also indented to make them visually more attractive. One thing to note, inside of back quotes, asterisks are no longer special. For example, if I say in computer font, 3 factorial is, back quote, 3 times 2 times 1, and the back quote, and put a period at the end of my sentence, and I run this, I get asterisks instead of italic, because again, inside of back quotes, asterisks don't have their special effect. You know, it would be great if there were some reference for how Markdown works. Let's open up a new section in our notebook called Markdown Reference. And we'd like to put a link into our notebook for people. And here's how you insert a link to a URL. You have your text, and the text that you want underlined and linkable goes in square brackets. So I can say, learn more about Markdown. And then immediately after the closing square bracket, you put a left parenthesis and the URL that you want. And in this case, it's https://commonmark.org/help/, and I close the parenthesis. And let's again put a period at the end to end our sentence. And when I run that cell, oh my goodness, invalid syntax. Why is that? Answer, I forgot to make it a markdown cell. No problem. I'll go and double click in my cell, change it from code to markdown. Ah, that looks a lot better. And now I can run the cell, and there the words learn more about markdown are a link, and when I click it, it opens up a new tab, and there's my cheat sheet for learning about markdown. Let's come here and save that notebook because we're finished with it. And we can close this tab. When we go to our home tab, in a couple of seconds, it should refresh. If it doesn't, we can refresh the page. Ah, there we go. There's our markdown.ipynb. Perfect. Hey, you know, I'd like to get rid of this untitled one. To get rid of something from a folder, you select it and then click delete. It asks, are you sure you want to permanently delete it? Yeah, it was the untitled notebook which didn't have anything in it, so away it goes. I can now close all my tabs in the browser, return to my Jupyter server, press Control-C, and yes, I want to shut it down. and then I can type exit to get out of my terminal program. And that's it for this video.